I would say we've probably studied with some of the greatest teachers, I would say, in the world. I think the violin is most like the human voice. Everything from my innermost soul comes out through the violin. And then when I perform and I communicate to the audience, it's such a great experience.
All four of us shared the passion for of course, to create music together. It's a lot like a family.
We're so thrilled that you're joining us tonight for the kickoff of this series that we are presenting in cooperation with Kwantlen Polytechnic University. You know, Science World has a mission, a mission to excite the community about science and technology and the importance of that in our lives and in the future prosperity of British Columbia. And people often think that science and technology, well, you know, that's test tubes and lab coats and maybe it's technology and cell phones and maybe it's healthcare. But science and technology is all around us in our lives. It's the design of the chairs that you're sitting on. It's the clothing that you're wearing, the car that you may have driven here tonight or come on the SkyTrain. And it's clearly all throughout the arts as well. You may have seen the artwork in the atrium on your way in tonight, and clearly it's behind the music that we're going to hear. We're so passionate about science and technology because it's so all pervasive in our lives, and tonight is just an example of that, as will the future presentation this series. I suspect many of you also, when you hear Science World, think of the big shiny dome on Falls Creek and a great place for families and young children. And we are that, and we treasure that reputation as well. But that's not all we are. We have a provincial mandate all around the province of British Columbia. And we have activities from young learners, early childhood development, 2-3-year-olds, right through the teen audience and a very active teen program, to activities for adults. And the opportunity to partner with KPU in reaching a broader audience is wonderful for us. And I mention partner because clearly, we're not going to do it all by ourselves in our vision. If we want to excite every British Columbia, every last one of them about science and technology, we need help. And that could be partnering with something, an attraction some of you may have heard of called the Eco Dairy, which is in Abbotsford. It means partnering with the Exploration Place Museum in Prince George in terms of delivery of our school programs, working with Northern Lights College and way up in Dawson Creek in Fort St. John. Or now, even more closely, working with Kwantlen Polytechnic University. And that opportunity we treasure, and we thank you for it. And to bring greetings and introduce this, we are pleased tonight to have with us Sal Ferreras, who is the Provo and Vice President Academic of Kwantlen, and coincidentally has a music background. There's something fishy in all of this, I think, but thank you for bringing this wonderful activity to Science World. So.
Well, thank you and good evening and welcome. Welcome to Science World. On behalf of our president, Dr. Alan Davis, who's out of town today, I bring greetings from Kwantlen Polytechnic University. I also want to thank Brian and Mila and all of the crew here for hosting us, for welcoming us, and for sort of coming on to what we thought was a great idea about having a series here at Science World. I've been here at this building since its inception when my kids were little, and I, you know, they stopped coming, but I kept coming. Some of the exhibits had music stuff and little toys and stuff, and they still have some upstairs, which you'll probably see later in the evening. But I want to say that the opportunity to make a series, to present a series with a partner such as Science World means an enormous amount to KPU in that we want to reach a wide community. We have a full range of sciences from the social sciences all the way to all sorts of trades and technologies that we want to make sure we feature. And we want everybody to know that the kind of stuff that we're doing out there is very much connected to the many of the things that you do see here. We'd like to acknowledge the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of the federal government, who provided the funding for tonight's presentation. This was based on an application by Dr. Daniel Bernstein, Canada Research Chair in Lifespan Cognition at KPU's Department of Psychology. And he's sitting right there. Thank you. And we want to thank Dr. Bernstein for his ongoing dedication to the expansion of science in our communities. Also, a big thank you to a big champion of this whole idea at KPU, and that's Dr. Diane Purvey, our dean from the Faculty of Arts. So you each received a little bag when you registered tonight, and inside you're going to find an evaluation form that we would appreciate you completing this evening. One of our lucky guests here tonight will have their evaluation drawn to win a prize. And now I'd like to introduce the group that's standing to my left, the Borealis String Quartet. First violin, Patricia Shi. Second violin, Yul Yanni. On viola, Nikita Pogrebnoy. And on cello, Bo Peng. They have been performing throughout Vancouver for many, many years, but even more so than Vancouver, they have a very, very important and widespread touring circuit, and have brought our glory of the music making in this city around the world. We have been associated with them as an ensemble in residence for the past year, and we have another full year of this residency, and we're thrilled to have them with us, and we're thrilled to have this presentation, have an opportunity for people to see music from a different perspective, and I'd like to enjoy, I hope that you enjoy the show, and I'd like to sort of turn it over to you, Yul, and have a wonderful, wonderful evening. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's just a delight to be here to share our passion for music with all of you. And I'm particularly happy to see so many young people here tonight. I think it's so great that you are here to kind of learn a little bit about what we do as musicians, and hopefully we can inspire you a little bit as well. Now, to begin tonight, I just want to talk a little bit about simply the physics of the instruments that we play. I mean, they are acoustic instruments. They're made from wood and crafted from a design that was somewhat perfected around the end of the 1600s, the 17th century. So these violins and violas and cello you'll see tonight were all really, haven't changed a whole lot since that time. There have been some simple modifications to the modernization of them, but in the whole, the acoustic properties and the design of them hasn't changed. And I can't think of anything that people use today that is being used in the capacity it was intended to be used for that was built 300 years ago. I had a violin, not this violin, but the violin I was using before was built in 1698. And I was playing concerts all over the world on this instrument. So to try and fathom that, it's really quite interesting. I mean, people have plates from maybe the 1800s and things that they might use daily, but what can you think of that people use on a daily basis, such as we do, musicians, as instruments like these? It's kind of interesting to think about. Now, the acoustic properties of these instruments revolve around the body of the instrument. This is called the body of the instrument, and it's made, the back and sides are made from maple, and the top usually of spruce, which is a slightly softer wood. And when the string vibrates, what is happening is the amplitude of the string is actually traveling down to the bridge. That's this part right here. And that amplitude is then goes down into the instrument. There's a post here called the sound post underneath the bridge that amplifies that in the sound chamber, and that resonates out through these F-shaped holes in the instrument. So acoustically, it's quite amazing that they can actually work. But really, over the years, the master makers, often from Italy, where we'll be next month, in Cremona, for example, they hand-carved all of these different parts. I think there are 128 parts on the violin, but the top is usually in two pieces. Oftentimes, the back is also in two pieces, though sometimes in one. And you can barely see the seam all the way down. It's just incredible, the craftsmanship. And from that, also what we call purfling, which is an inlay of ebony around the edges. I don't know if you can see that black around the edges. It helps to prevent any cracking from the sides continuing up the instrument. So it's really a work of art that that we use every day. So it's a real privilege. Now, really, you can't make any sound except with your finger like this without the bow. And this piece of wood and horsehair is really another marvel of the music world. I mean, first of all, they use the tail of a horse. Isn't that interesting? They actually cut the tail of a horse to have the hair on the bow to create the sound on the instrument. Now, the bow itself is a concave shape, the modern bow now, and with it, it's somewhat like an artist's paintbrush. You know, we use it to create colors in sound, if you like. And what is important, another important aspect to the horsehair is that without the use of rosin, which is derived from the resin of trees, you've seen sap, that sticky fluid that oozes out of trees. Well, when that's melted down, they can create what's called rosin, and we take our bow hair and we gently rub it back and forth on the rosin, and it enables the bow to stick. Without it, we wouldn't have any sound. It would just be something like this. But with the rosin, it actually creates a sound. So that's how the physics of the instrument work in terms of its craftsmanship and the essentials to it. Now, to actually make music, we have to combine what we're doing with this right hand with the placement of our fingers on the string. And this placement on the string, it establishes the pitch. So the length of the string is from the bridge to the nut here at this end to this end. And the space between where we place our finger on it creates the different tone. Now, any physicists in the room would know that the middle of the string creates an octave. So if I play an open string, and I place my finger in the middle of that string, it creates an octave above. And also, conversely, between that note and the other in a quarter of the string creates an octave above. So that's just a simple insight into the physics of the string. Now, you can imagine that there are infinite combinations of what we do with our left hand and the right hand, but in general, the right hand is used to produce the sound. It uses weight and speed, as well as the contact point, which is the distance from the bridge. And that sounds like an immaterial point, but if you imagine when we play somewhere here, and we move closer to the bridge, already we have a dramatic increase in the sound. So those are just some of the things that we have in our palette of tools to create sound with the right hand. So now the left hand does play an important role, of course, because it's playing the pitch that we have. And also, in addition to that, we can use what is called vibrato. And that is essentially, you've seen those graphs of sounds that have the amplitude waves. Well, that's what we're doing with vibrato. Can we get it narrower so that we have that kind of a vibrato? And it can be used as a wonderful expressive tool in depending upon the amplitude, the width, the speed, and the intensity. So that's those are sort of some of the other tools that we have. Now, all of these are just factors that are needed just simply to play the instrument. Now, you can imagine that in a quartet, when there are four people playing all at the same time, to coordinate these aspects is of utmost importance. It's our job as musicians to express the music as a unit together, which in some regards is quite a superhuman feat when you can, you know, consider all of the physical aspects, the physics of it, and not to mention the individuals having to play together and communicate. So an interesting scientific fact that I recall about chamber musicians is once they had electrodes on the heads of quartet musicians, and they were sight-reading music. And the pictures of these brain scans were just astounding. Essentially, every area of the brain was firing. It was like the end of a fireworks show, you know, how everything goes off at once. People's minds were just going like crazy, because there are so many aspects of things we have to rely on. We're relying on our visual stimulus from the music on the page, our audio response, hearing the notes, our own response to that, but also in addition to that, our colleagues around us, and maybe in the case of sight reading, we don't really know what's going to happen, so we don't know what's next, so we really are reading ahead and trying to anticipate. So a lot of things are happening in our brains when we're trying to do this kind of thing, which we'll demonstrate shortly. Now, all I've been speaking to is the sound that we make as musicians. Now, what makes music special is that it incorporates not only sound, but rhythm. And I kind of think of rhythm as time in space. It's sort of the organization of sound and how we put it together. And it's this combination of sound and rhythm, I think, that really is creating the music. And with that, we have the expression that, as artists, we add and collectively try to communicate. So I'm going to go on now and just have the quartet play some musical examples that just illustrate some ideas about how this music is put together and some of the ways in which we, as an ensemble, put the music into an expressive framework, and how a composer will elicit aspects of the different instruments. So to begin with, I'm just going to actually ask each of them to just play a simple musical example from the piece to illustrate the register, the sort of timbre of each of these instruments. We're going to first begin with violin. Patricia's just going to play a quick excerpt from the first movement of the Dvorak string quartet we will perform in a moment. Thank you. Now, if we consider the string quartet somewhat like a vocal ensemble, that would represent the soprano. As you can hear, the register and tonality is very high in its tessitura. Next, the viola is somewhat more like the tenor of the string quartet in its register. Nikita, would you just play the same? Now, that was quite different, wasn't it? Did you notice how much lower and the sound quality was a little bit, you could say it was a little darker or warmer maybe than the more brightly and energetic first violin. Now, the difference between the violin and the viola is significant. Maybe Patricia, you and Nikita could just stand up and place your instruments side by side. So you can see that the violin is significantly smaller. There's a joke that, you know, what's the difference between a violin and a viola? And the simple reality is that a viola burns longer. And violists often are the butt of many jokes, so I won't continue there. But there is a difference in, obviously, the sound quality and the tonal production when you have a different sized instrument. Next, in the cello, I'm going to ask Bode, he's just going to play a short excerpt as well, just to demonstrate a little bit of the upper register of the cello. Now, the cello, as you can see, is much larger than the violin and equally larger, well, not equally, obviously, but larger than the viola. Could you just hold up the viola beside you guys, just to tell us? So you can see that the sound box is significantly bigger. Now, cellos have different strings than the violins. Patricia, could you just play the open strings? We have an E, A, D, and finally G. That's how the instruments are tuned, each of the four strings. Next, on viola, could you play yours beginning on the A string? So that's significantly lower. That's the lowest note that the viola plays. Now, the cello has the same pitched strings as the viola, starting on the A, the D, the G, and then finally the C string. But listen to the difference. Now, that's quite a low sounding note, isn't it? Okay, so we're going to play then some brief examples from this quartet, the Dvorak String Quartet, American Opus 96, number 1. And just to give you a sense of how the piece fits together, and show how some of these things that we've been talking about actually work in this piece. So to start, we're going to just play a little bit of the beginning, and just notice how each instrument joins to create a palette, a wonderful sound quality to support the entrance of the viola, which has the solo at the beginning. Short. Don't worry, you get to hear the rest of the piece soon. Now, as you can hear, you heard the lowest register in the cello, the upper register in the first violin, and the tenor register in the viola. Now, when I started to play, it's kind of like the alto range. So when a composer is composing for string quartet, he considers those ranges of the different instruments for the tonal palette with this ensemble. Now, the next one we're going to play really is an example of use the same material, the same motif, played in all four different instruments. Now, together, we played really the same motive, one bar at a time, but together, we've knitted them together to create a phrase. The next example is also another one that involves a motive. So four notes that are passed, again, through the group, but you can hear the different timbre of the different instruments. And the composer, I think, had something in mind when he did this. So here is a second example from that. That example had a lot of things that I talked about before, didn't it? It had the register, it had the different pressures with the bow, and the different articulations that we can do with the bow as well. So next we're going to go on to the second movement, and it's a very different character and mood. The music that is being expressed here has a more sorrowful character, more of a sadder feeling. And that's one of the wonderful things that we're able to do, combining all of the things that we talked about at the beginning, to really communicate human feelings. And I think that's what's so special about music. So I'm going to play another excerpt that has differing rhythms layered and creating an atmosphere for the melody to begin. So, you see how we were using our bows differently? I don't know if you noticed how smooth that was as opposed to some of the more short articulated sounds we made with the bow before. Now, I'm going to move on next to the third movement and play just the opening of this movement to give you a sense of what the character of this movement is. And notice that two instruments at a time seem to play the melody. So we begin in the cello and violin, second violin, and it's responded to at the end of the phrase, or the next phrase, with the upper violins, first violin, second violin, viola. And just notice how the sound is different in its timbre. Now, something that is important when we're playing is what we call dynamics. And what dynamics are is the amount of volume that we use. So in this case, we started with a forte, which is considered a moderately loud and full sound. And then it was followed by, like an echo, piano, which is quieter. And then again, forte, and then pianissimo, which is even quieter. So what I guess is important to note is how with these bows and instruments, we can, through sound, have these different levels of dynamics that impact how we can express the music. Now, one example, or two examples that I'm going to give next, show how, as in a group, we can start and play something more full, and together we diminuendo. That's the word that means to go from louder to softer. And then the second example is the reverse, to go from soft to loud. A simple example of how, as a group, we're going from soft to loud. So within this framework, all of us, with the music and that the composer has written, try to achieve, through the means of the right hand and left hand, all of these musical expressions and put it together as a piece of music. So now we're going to play the complete piece of Dvorak, his American String Quartet, Opus 96 in F major. It's in four movements. We've given, except for the last movement, we've played an excerpt of each. The last movement is just a wonderful finale, very bubbly and fresh. And so we hope you'll enjoy this performance. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being a wonderful audience tonight. And we so hope you enjoyed the Dvorak and perhaps leave tonight with a little bit of a deeper understanding of what we do. So thank you so much. And I think I should invite Stephen.
I have the pleasure this evening of representing KPU tonight to thank the Borealis String Quartet. That's just an incredible performance. I never realized that playing music was so physical. The movement up there was quite inspiring. So we would like to thank Patricia Shi, Yul Yanni, Nikita Pogrebny, and Bo Peng. And we'd also like to thank all of you for sharing tonight with us and coming out to join us. We also look forward to the next installment of the KPU Science World Speaker Series, August 12th, featuring Dr. Kent Mulnix on the topic, Building Sustainable Food Systems for the 21st Century, Life Science-Based or Ecologically Insensitive. Please don't forget to complete the evaluations that you received earlier tonight so that you can be submitted to enter into our draw. Lastly, I'd like to welcome everyone up to the Eureka Room upstairs for some refreshments. Thank you once again. Thank you.